Okay, good morning. Thank you very much for the introduction, Mark, and thank you very much for the invitation. Well, planetary urbanization and the challenge of sustainable development. Here we have, of course, two terms that we have to explain. I start with sustainable development. I don't really start with that because that could go on for ages. But very short, sustainable development is a concept. It is a kind of a rule that was in a certain way imposed almost on a global scale. And of course it is also an ideology and it is an excuse for all kinds of things. And it is finally a very controversial term, and I will return to that at the end of my contribution. Urbanization. Urbanization, of course, again, I could explain for hours what that means. Maybe just one key point. I guess everybody in this room knows that. And it became famous as the kind of hypothesis of the urban age, was put forward by the London School of Economics, and this famous book, The Endless City. And this book is very much based on the idea that today 50% of world's population is living in cities. Now, if we look very carefully on that idea, then we see that there is a whole range of assumptions behind that. And the main thing is, on the one hand side, we have like two containers, and one container is the rural container and the other container is the urban container, and we have a kind of constant shift from the rural to the urban. And we can clearly identify that there are two worlds, the rural world and the urban world. And if we go more into the detail of that, then we see that this is a quite ahistorical assumption, because urbanization is a process that is much broader than just bringing people from the rural container to the urban container. And that's a kind of programmatic proposition to think about urbanization and its effects. And that's something that I'm just developing at this moment together with Neil Brenner. And he's also a sociologist, and he's at Harvard at the GSD. And we are working together on these ideas of global and planetary urbanization. So, first of all, we have to see that the urban and the rural and urbanization is not just something like a chair or a table that is clear what it is, but it is something that has to be defined. It is something that that has many facets and many aspects, and it needs a kind of theoretical engagement to define these terms. So it's not just given, it's not just clear. Second point, it is a socio-spatial phenomenon. So it is not just like territories that you can say, okay, all settlements that are larger than 10,000, that have more than 10,000 inhabitants, they are urban, and if you have 9,999, then it's rural. It does not work like that. It's a socio-spatial phenomenon, and it's a phenomenon that we have to look very carefully. We have to look on the people, how they live, how they behave, how their everyday life is organized. Point three, from urban form to urban process. Urbanization is a process, is not a form. And that's a key moment, and that's, I think, the most difficult to really understand also in empirical research. Urbanization is something that develops, that is in constant change. So if we are discussing about cities, we are very often discussing about forms And if you look on the terms that were labeled in the last, let's say, 10, 20 years, starting with global city and edge city and future city, it's always cities, and it is always like a form. But actually, if we look carefully, then we see it's a process, it's in constant change, and we have to understand this change. That's the key point of the engagement with the urban question. Point four, concentrated and extended urbanization. We are very often looking just on concentrated urbanization. So we are looking, oh, the cities are growing and growing, and these are agglomerations, and they are becoming urban regions, and they are becoming urban mega regions. And but this is only half of the medal. There are also many aspects that are going to the other side, that are extended over the planet. And we have many, many aspects that that are where we see that urbanization, as with networks, with the transformation of the landscape, with many, many effects, are extending over the whole planet. I will just come back to that in a second. Point five, urbanization leads to increasing differences. And that's, I think, an important point, because very often it is looked at these processes like, oh, this is a kind of homogenization of the planet. But if you look carefully, we see that we have a whole universe of different urban forms and different urban processes that are developing all over the world. And so urbanization is not just homogenizing, it has also certain aspects in that, but it is at the same time also differentiating. So this is like a program along 5 points, and maybe in 1 or 2 years you could read something about that in more detail. Now, planetary urbanization, and this follows now a little bit out of what I just explained. Maybe to give you just a short illustration, what does that mean, planetary urbanization, and at the same time, what does it mean, extended urbanization? This is also urbanization. And these are the global shipping lines that are affecting our oceans. And very often this is just neglected, this is just outside, it is outside the large cities, but it is a key element, global shipping lanes. It has many effects. Just some days ago you could read in the newspaper a report on plastic waste islands in the middle of the Pacific Ocean and in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, and probably also somewhere here around. So plastic islands that are in the middle of a perfectly, completely empty space. But this space is not empty, this space is already urbanized in a certain way. And we had a wonderful presentation 2 days ago in Zurich in the context of FCL. And it was exactly following these shipping lines and was analyzing the Straits of Singapore as a kind of urbanized territory. So that's exactly what extended urbanization also means. It has a lot of other consequences, but of course I don't have enough time to explain all those. Now, Neil Brenner and me, we just made a short kind of account on certain phenomena that are related with this planetary urbanization. So one point, the creation of new scales of urbanization. For instance, if you look on the Pearl River Delta, is started with Hong Kong and with Guangzhou, and now is a kind of an area with about 120 million people living there. It is a kind of completely new dimension of urbanization. So all the terms we have, like agglomeration and even conurbation, and mega city region, even does not really apply again. So we have urbanization in that combination of concentrated urbanization and extended urbanization produces completely new geographies and new urban situations. And one of those is that also the scale is changing. The blurring and rearticulation of urban territories, this means that we have inside of these urban territories a lot of new developments. We have suddenly new centralities that arrive, where maybe some years ago there were still cows grazing, or there were still, I don't know, banana plantations and so on. I mean, so we have a much more complex urban situation in today's urban territories. And the disintegration of the hinterland, that's also an important thing, so that the hinterland that just used to be a kind of supplier for the urban regions are becoming more and more independently and are becoming export processing zones and are becoming much more complex urban configurations. And a very good example is again Singapore, and it's always looked at Singapore, at the island, but there is a hinterland of Singapore in Malaysia and in Indonesia. This hinterland becomes more and more important, becomes larger and larger, and it becomes more and more complex. And the last point here, the end of the wilderness. The wilderness actually does not really exist anymore. The Amazon is urbanized, the deserts are urbanized, the Alps are urbanized. One of these aspects of planetary urbanization. Now, if you look on certain representation, it's difficult to represent this kind of planetary urbanization. So that's a classic representation. The largest cities, these are all agglomerations in the world with more than 1 million inhabitants. And that's, of course, a representation of concentrated urbanization, but there is also something more. Now, that's also a very famous representation of the urbanization process. And everybody thinks, oh yeah, that's the urban, but that's not the urban. That's actually pollution, okay? That's light pollution. This is just a side effect. We can ask, is that really showing the bright light of the city? So where the light is the city. Is that really, working? There are a lot of other phenomena that we don't see, but they are also part of urbanization. What's that? That's density, population density on a large scale in the world. Everybody thinks, yes, of course, density means cities. Please have a look. Where are the most densely populated areas in the world? Here and here. Okay, that's quite rural, that too. So that does not show urbanization, that shows something else. And we have to be very careful if we think that the most densely populated areas in the world are the urban areas. They are rural, and this rural is maybe not so rural anymore, it's maybe changing. And there are a lot of important processes going on. We have to look much more carefully on these processes. Okay, and then, this is what is called urban extents, so the footprint of urbanization. But again, this shows only the footprint that is really kind of massively concentrated. It does not show the footprint, the urban footprint, in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. Okay, now I think the next point, important point, is specificity and urbanization. It's a project that is at the moment produced at ETH Studio Basel, Contemporary City Institute, and it tries to understand how urbanization is going on. And it starts with the idea that, and it's in a certain way the antithesis to the famous thesis of the generic city, that cities are not so generic, but they are quite specific. And this by necessity. Just one example, we are just producing a book, and the first example in the book will be Naples. What makes Naples very specific is, of course, Vesuvius. That's, I think, an interesting lesson we can learn from that. Because it shows us one element of the specificity, and it shows us that still, let's say, nature, or first nature, still plays an important role in urbanization processes. So here, the main actor is the volcano, And as we all know, this volcano from time to time, it explodes, it erupts, and sometimes with devastating effects. So this was about 200 years ago. And some 2,000 years ago, everybody knows, Pompeii, Herculaneum, there was a devastating explosion of the volcano. Today it looks like that, very idyllic, very nice. And if we go one step further, we see that the urbanization process did not respect that. So the urbanization, we see it not so well here on that, but the urban area, so these are the dangerous areas, different dangers that are coming from the volcano, and the urban area just started to entangle the volcano in the last 100 years. And we can ask, how is that possible? Today we know everything about the volcano. Vesuvius is the most famous volcano in the world, the best researched volcano in the world, and in that dangerous area are living 500,000 people, and you have about 12 hours to escape if you have the first sign of the volcano. And all these 500,000 people, they need maybe 3 days, 4 days to escape. And the question is, how is that possible? And so we see one element of urbanization is, on the one hand, we have a kind of first nature, and here we have a very unstable first nature, a moving first nature, and then urbanization creates a second nature. And in that case, it is not at all, it does not match the danger of the first nature. So first nature is in movement, second nature is just produced, constructed around it, like a second element, and first nature is in constant motion, and second nature is stable and fixed, and the result is possibly devastating. And there is an impasse, and there is almost no solution, because it's not possible to relocate 500,000 people in the next years. So they are just staying there and hoping the volcano does not explode. But it will explode, maybe not tomorrow, maybe not in 10 years, but sooner or later it will, and then we have a catastrophe. Everybody knows it, everybody lives with it. So that's also an aspect of urbanization. So we have to be very careful about the lessons. There are so many lessons, but can they be applied? Difficult question. Very often not. Now, we see now that urbanization has different dimensions, and this comes from Henri Lefebvre's theory of the production of space. What I just explained is the material production of the built environment that has to handle also the natural forces that are underlying these processes. Then we have also a production of knowledge, and we have regulation and representation. And that's one key problem in Naples, that the regulation is in a way that we have an impasse, you cannot solve the problem of the volcano. And then we have also socialization and learning processes, and we have everyday life, and people, they think, oh, a city is, if you lived in Los Angeles, you think, oh yeah, a city is like Los Angeles. It is extended, it is decentralized, and if you are living in Paris, you think, yes, of course, a city is very concentrated and dense. And we should not forget that these kind of experiences are very much influencing also our discussions and our way how we are analyzing. Even as scientists, very often we are not really safe of these experiences. Now, comparative analysis, and that's something that we are applying now to understand these processes better in the context of FCL, Module 5, Urban Sociology. And we are doing a project that compares 9 cities, pretty large cities all over the world. Urban comparative strategies, how could we do it? I cannot go into detail. There is a wonderful paper published by Jennifer Robinson, and it starts with the idea that maybe you cannot compare examples because they are all unique. Then you have individualizing strategies, you have universalizing strategies that are saying everything goes in the same direction, and we have just to find out the kind of main kind of components of the development. Then you have encompassing strategies that are trying to establish whole kind of huge models. And then you have also variation finding strategies. And Robinson ends then her text with the proposal we should have more experimental comparisons. So we are in a certain way stepping into that last point. Now, how can we analyze urbanization processes? So we look at, of course, extended urban regions. So we look very much on concentrated urbanization, but we look also on these areas in the extended way. Just three examples, and you see already how different they are. Kolkata, Mexico City, Paris. And then we look on patterns and pathways. That's our main grid. Start with pathways, so we have to periodize the production of space. And just an example, Mexico City. I mean, yesterday in the discussion, there was the point, well, Switzerland has a massive growth, so it's almost doubled in the last 30 or 40 years. Now, Mexico City, in 1950, it had about 3 million inhabitants, 3 million in 1950, which is already a pretty large city, I mean, if you think. And today it has something like 20 million in 50 years, from 3 to 20. And you can imagine, what does that mean? If already large city becomes a kind of a mega city. I mean, you see that there must be, like a state of emergency, a constant state of emergency to house and to host and to create a kind of living conditions for all these people. Yeah, and then we can look on different patterns, on different pathways. So that's Mexico City and that's Paris. Yeah, and then next level, patterns of urbanization. Our strategy here is mainly to map, to work with kind of special ways of mapping, and the origin of that strategy and of that method is this nice four books that Marc Angelil also mentioned, Switzerland and Urban Portrait. And there we made a first approach to analyze Switzerland. And in a certain way, before we had the term, but I would say today, we analyzed planetary urbanization in Switzerland. And we analyzed the different ways that Switzerland is urbanized. And I think one of the main points here was that we managed finally to show that Switzerland is a completely urbanized country. So forget about the rural. All of these elements of Switzerland, all the parts of Switzerland are urbanized in different ways. And so we developed the whole typology of different urban areas and starts with metropolitan region and goes on with networks of cities and alpine resorts and quiet zones. And that, of course, was a huge debate, or created a huge debate, the alpine fallow lands. So that's for Switzerland. And now we could apply maybe this method to other examples. Another example is Havana. And there we use this mapping methods, not fully deliberately, but because there was a lack of data. We still think we have data all over the world. It's not true. We have a lot of blind spots. We have a lot of areas where we have almost no really reliable data. And one of these places is Havana. And so we produced our own data by mapping. For instance, socioeconomic differences in Havana, there is no data. Officially, there are no socioeconomic differences in Havana. And in a workshop, we then produced this map, which might be quite accurate. Of course, very general, but it helps us to understand. So we have just four zones. So low income, medium income, high income, and very high income. Yes, and this is the way we produced it. A lot of discussions. And then we thought, okay, maybe we could use this, and then we produced out of that also a very detailed analysis of the whole city and different elements of the city, different urbanization patterns of the city. Now, we thought, okay, we can also use that for our comparative approach. And so in the Singapore project, we are now producing also these kind of maps out of sometimes statistical data, if available, but mainly out of interviews and discussions and mapping sessions with different experts. And so we are developing an understanding of these cities out of their own logic, out of their own situation, that is not just kind of derived from already existing concepts. And so this is Istanbul, and this is Kolkata, and this is Paris. I don't go into the details, but you can imagine that now I could really start to explain a lot of things. Now, the main point was to find out what kind of urbanization processes are shaping these cities. So the goal is now to understand all these cities as not just as urban forms, but as a kind of force field of urban processes. And if you look on that process of urbanization, and we look on what we have at hand today, then we have to say we are still quite an alphabet. We have just suburbanization and peri-urbanization and de-urbanization and gentrification and urban regeneration, and then more or less that's it. And all of these concepts, almost all of these concepts, are North American concepts, and there is also some English concepts. And the rest of the world is not really represented in, even continental Europe is not really represented in these processes. Suburbanization is the suburb, and the suburb is the suburb, and the suburb is North American. And gentrification was labeled in England, in London, and so on. And now we apply all these concepts to all the cities in the world, and this does not work. It leads to a total misunderstanding of the urbanization processes. And so out of our kind of experiences and of our analysis and of our mapping sessions, we are now developing new categories that are, well, coming from below in a certain way. So in confronting, let's say, examples from Tokyo with examples of Mexico City, we try to develop new concepts and new understandings and new, of course, also terms to analyze urbanization. And so we have new terms. I mean, they are still very provisional. It's a work in progress, but we are now trying to make it more sound. So we have, for instance, development of old and new centralities. This may be not so astonishing. Then we have commodification of urban differences. And this brings together the creation of differences in Tokyo and processes like gentrification and processes like urban regeneration in other cities. And then we have a term like popular urbanizations. And that brings together all kinds of developments, starting from informal settlements up to self-constructed houses and up to, let's say, self-organized urban territories. And we found out that there's a whole universe, and just the term informal does not really help us to understand all these processes. So we tried to find a new term. And here we compared examples, of course, of Istanbul, of Mexico City, of Lagos, of Kolkata, and tried to find out what could be a term that really brings together all these different examples. Okay, I have still 2 minutes. So we made some examples. I bring now the example that we call mass housing production. And here we start with Hong Kong, because this is actually the first example where the mass housing production started in the 1950s. And we continue then with Paris. At almost the same time, we also have this kind of what is in Paris called les grands ensembles, this huge housing estates that were produced in the 50s and 60s, and today create huge problems, huge difficulties, are demolished, are refurbished, are a kind of constant problem that is almost where it is almost not possible to solve it. A little bit like the volcano in Naples, but this is exclusively man-made. And then we think, yeah, that's the past. I mean, that's the 50s, the 60s, of course. I mean, they did not understand how urbanization works, so they made a lot of mistakes. Now we have an example. This is Istanbul. This is also an example. Maybe much better example, much more sophisticated example, and we had already quite some interesting accounts on that in Singapore. And then we look on other actual examples here. Istanbul, this is in the last 10 years, and a very similar form and very similar problems, maybe in the future. So it is this kind of mass housing production is not just something from the past, but is also something for the future. And we should also look on this kind of examples. This is Mexico City, mega conjuntos, and this kind of this is like a mass production of cars, but there are no cars but houses, and they are in the peripheries, and they are without proper infrastructure, and they are without all the urban facilities that are necessary to really have an urban life, and they are repeating so many mistakes that were done in Paris, in Hong Kong, in many other places. So I come to the end, the challenge of sustainable development. We think that we make, this is like a kind of a general framework, and we should all produce more sustainably, and we should have a sustainable urban development. And we should learn, and we should have best practice. And if we look on what really is going on, we see that the lessons from the past are not learned, the lessons from the present are maybe not possible to apply and to implement in these places, because the world is not just kind of an empty plane, but the world is already full of all different kind of forces, and urbanization process is of course something that is in one hand side universal, but on the other hand side very specific. And if you want to have sustainable urban development, we should be very careful with the lessons that we promote. We have to really look on the concrete cases, and we see that these concrete cases are much more differentiated and much more, there's a much higher heterogeneity and variability than we usually are learned to see. So that's also a project to learn to see the differences and to understand much better these local conditions. Thank you very much for your attention.
I have some time
for discussion, or
we'll go to the discussion.
Okay.